Now, I didn't just assemble you all here today to show off my hairdresser's most recent terrible mistake. I actually have some other problems I need to solve. Namely, in regards to this 100 plus terabyte NAS I built in a recent video, which, after I built it, I immediately ran into some massive networking bottleneck.
In fact, according to this data transfer calculator, the process is gonna take 6.5 days.
And today, I'm gonna try and solve that problem with some of the cheapest 10 gigabit networking I could find. And I also need to just generally deal with some of the networking issues in this office, because I've just been ignoring them slowly since I moved in, kinda like global warming. So yeah, let's address some of that today. Now, the only couple things that have changed since I did the video where I built the NAS was I got one of these IKEA Kallaxes to put it on, which is some real professional server grade furniture, the building of which went very well. Yeah, I'd say that hole looks cabley. And I've also added this Wi-Fi 7 TP-Link router, which is mainly for VR purposes, but it's been fine. Yeah, it's worked. The main problem has been, because of the absurd amount of data that I need to move between this NAS and my editing system, my gigabit network infrastructure is really struggling to keep up with it. So what I ended up doing was buy some of the cheapest 10 gigabit network infrastructure I could find. I think it's a really good idea. I'm sure a brand like Lemspum is well renowned in the networking industry. But before I install all of this stuff and see how that goes, there is a bit of a general networking issue I need to deal with in the office first. Now, there were some pre-installed LAN cables, which you can see kind of runs along the walls here, and it's sometimes in tubes, which also carries power. You can see these are how the outlets kind of run around the walls. And then the Cat6 cables terminate like this at various points along the wall, which is very useful infrastructure to just find pre-installed in a new space, but there's a little bit of an issue with it. This is what the nexus of all of these cables look like. Whoever used this space before just cut off whatever bit of thing it was they used to terminate the ends of all of these cables. And because the routed cables have been castrated, what I've been doing in the meantime is just run my own LAN cables along the floor next to them like some kind of animal. But luckily, all I have to do now to rectify my savagery is terminate these cables myself. And there are two potential ways I can go about that. Now, option number one, which was suggested by the person who came and installed our internet here, which is actually a viewer of the channel, hello Colin, but he suggested that we use like a patch panel to terminate all of those cables. And he was actually kind enough to even give me a patch panel to terminate all of these cables with, which seems real professional. You can see that you kind of terminate the cables on here. And this definitely seems like the kind of thing used by somebody that knows what they're doing. The thing is though, because I'm gonna have all of my network switches and stuff right here, I don't want to have to run another bunch of LAN cables from here straight into the network switch. That feels a little bit wasteful to me. So what I'm gonna do instead is terminate those cables and plug them straight into the network switch, which makes sense to me. I feel like that should be fine, and that way I have to terminate slightly fewer cables, I guess? I don't know, we'll see how it turns out. Now to do this, I bought an RJ45 crimp tool, which not only comes with the tool, but a whole bunch of connectors as well, so pretty much everything I need. Wow, this looks like a thing I'm not qualified to use. Okay, so this is starting to feel a bit more real now that I'm actually looking at all of these cables. The first thing I did was unconjoin the clump of cables, separating out the cables going to the two halves of the office. This was in an attempt to make it slightly easier for me to trace what goes where, but in the process, I made two very important discoveries. Okay, so I followed the cables along the wall, and the white one I shouldn't worry about because it goes into the office next door and I don't really want to connect them to my network. Oh, but they're numbered. So this is 876. Oh, so this may actually not be that difficult to do. Oh, these are also numbered, yay! Okay, that's very good. Then came step two, figuring out how to make RJ45 happen, which I decided to just figure out on the job.
Wow, stripping cables is so much easier when you're not just using a knife.
Next, I'm not sure if I need to strip the inner cables or not, so let's give it a try and see how easy that is to do.
A few moments later.
Very difficult is the answer. Okay, so I'm just gonna give it a try without stripping it and see what happens.
Okay, so there is a little plastic core which doesn't need to be attached to the connector, so I'm gonna cut that off. There are like a lot of different diagrams here, and all of them use naming schemes that I don't recognize. Well, I mean, I know what RJ45 is.
I then tried to match the colors of the cables I had to the ones on the diagram, but eventually just gave up and chose the bottom diagram for some reason.
I gotta like straighten them out. This goes into the cut bit for some reason. So orange went on, or like orange stripey. No, don't fall out, okay. Like, surely this is something a robot can do.
Solid blue wasn't cooperating for a while there, but it's come around. I then spent ages struggling to get little cables through little holes with the occasional screw up.
Oh, that one's not in the correct spot. Oh, they're in the wrong holes.
But I got there eventually.
Yay.
Oh no, I forgot to record the first crimp. But I mean, either way, that looks like a LAN cable to me. So let's plug it in and test it. So I figured out where 8 goes, and it's reasonably useful, but it's by all my camera crap. Oh, why do laptops even have batteries? They're always dead. Hey, it actually worked! First try even, so I'm clearly some kind of LAN cable making prodigy. All I had to do now was repeat this process like 5 more times. Stripping, rubbing, squeezing, and cutting ad nauseam. But eventually, with my fingers tired and dehydrated, I had a functional network. So now that we've sorted out all of our cables, it's time to selectively upgrade to 10 gigabit. Now, considering that we have a bunch of Cat 6 cables about the place, which does technically support 10 gigabit Ethernet, I could go that route, but it's not cheap enough. A much cheaper option is going with fiber optic 10 gigabit. These two Lemspun SFP cards, for example, only cost me $58 Canadian each. And besides, fiber optic is always cooler. And aside from cost, I also went with the Lemspun because it's got an Intel chipset in it, which means it should have good support. So let's open it up and have a look. Oh yeah, there it is. What a beauty. We've got quite the heatsink on it. And then this is our fiber optic 10 gigabit Ethernet connector. And as you can tell, it's quite a chunky connector because there's a lot of connector that needs to go into it. There's DACs and all kinds of stuff that needs to happen there. But I'm hoping this should be a fine solution. So I got two of them because, well, I need one in my editing system and then one for the actual NAS so that they can communicate between each other at super high speeds. But I'm not going to connect them straight to each other because I still want the NAS connected to the rest of my network. So I decided to go with a TrendNet 6-port multi-gig switch because, again, it was very inexpensive. And this switch has 2 of our 10 gigabit connectors, and then it's got 4 standard Ethernet connectors, which I think support up to 2.5 gigabit. And there it is. It looks like a network switch. So with that, I'm gonna drop these cards into the systems and take it from there. Now, first thing, I am gonna have to move the GT710 down into the slot where the gigabit network card is in because, well, we need a full-size PCIe Express slot for the 10 gigabit network card. Oh, that is super annoying. Because of the orientation of the power connector on the wall wart, it's real annoying to implement on a power strip. You're either gonna have it take up a whole bunch of ports, or you have to have it at the end hanging over. So I'm gonna use that to connect it to the Wi-Fi router. And then this 1 meter cable is gonna go between the switch and the NAS. Whoa, these are such serious connectors. Look at that. You've even got some DAC modules in there. Oh yeah, that's a nice connector. And then this 3 meter cable is hopefully long enough to reach my PC. I hope.
Okay. Oh, please be long enough.
Oh, it's so close. That is tragic. What in the world? Okay, I guess I'm just gonna have to route it not behind the sound panels.
Wow, that is
just about long enough.
So now comes the moment of truth. Power up this system.
A few moments later.
Okay, that's not a great start.
But all I had to do was replug in my old Ethernet and download some drivers for the card.
Hey, success, look at that. Okay, well now I need to see if I can find the NAS on the network.
I found it immediately. The LEMS bum was plug and play with the NAS, and copying files from my PC to the NAS went from this to this.
Whoa, that's so fast. Now this is straight from this system onto the NAS. I'm not using the like toaster hard drive thing, which I'm sure will be a lot slower because that's gonna be the bottleneck. But still, that is a lot faster than I was expecting. And that kind of use case is how I'm normally gonna use it. But let's drop a toaster drive in there and see what that does. It's basically exactly the same speed. I mean, it's a little bit faster. It's gone from hovering between 100 and 110 to hovering between 110 and 130. So, I guess the hard drive caddy is a huge bottleneck. Although, I potentially have a way around it. So I'm gonna cancel this. So what I'm gonna do here, which isn't super ghetto at all, but I'm just gonna plug the drive in like this. I feel like we should put the drive flat on the ground so that it doesn't fall over mid-transfer. Okay, well the plot thickens. Apparently the drive is the issue and not the toaster oven. So when it comes to initially copying the like archive footage onto the NAS, I'm gonna have to spend the rest of my life waiting for that to happen, unfortunately.
But then something interesting happened. It started copying faster. Wait a minute, I've left it for a bit, and it's like it's spun up its warp drive or something, but look at that! It's almost twice as fast now! It does drop back down to about 100-ish every now and then, but that's significantly better! Wow, I'm so much more excited about this now, although I was already pretty excited, but yay! Even the archiving is gonna take a little bit faster. Which is good, because I did put this off for like 3 weeks. So it could have been done 3 times over by now, but still, now it's gonna happen faster, which means it's better. That's a way to end a video.